Good evening. I'm Peter Yudis, and I wanted to address one particular question, and that is, why have we embarked on this effort to produce a complete works of Rosa Luxemburg that will, after all, fill 14 volumes? Why embark on such an arduous task now? Well, I'm sure that nobody who has looked at or gets a chance to read in full the companion volume for the complete works, this 600-page collection, The Letters of Rosa Luxemburg, that Annalise Leschiska had first done a German edition of back in the late 80s, can fail to be struck by the multidimensionality of Luxemburg's interests and the richness of her personality. The letters certainly show her mastery of economic theory as well as politics, her wide-ranging knowledge and passion for literature as well as history, and her absorbing personality, which took delight in all things natural as well as some of the most mundane aspects of human existence. And that certainly comes out especially when she was writing from within the confines of the prison walls. Yet The Letters of Rosa Luxemburg, to be truthful, is only the tip of the iceberg. Even with this volume, about 85% of her letters have never yet appeared in English. Moreover, close to 80% of her total writings, which include essays, articles, reviews, pamphlets, manuscripts, have never been published in English at all. This includes one of the most important books, The Introduction to Political Economy, which will appear in full for the first time in English in the first volume of the complete works that we're now working on, Economic Writings, 1897 to 1907. And this is not to mention a large number of manuscripts by Luxemburg that have only been discovered in the past decade or two, and which will also appear for the first time in the complete works. Now, obviously, producing this 14-volume collection is going to take a lot of work, especially because, thanks to the great help and assistance of the Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung in Berlin, we're not only going to be rendering new translations of all of Luxemburg's work, but retranslations, more up-to-date English translations of works of hers that have previously appeared in English. So why do this and why do it now? Well, I think the answer is that Luxemburg was such a remarkably multidimensional thinker and personality that it's about time that we had access to the entire corpus of her work to critically examine and rethink, given the many ways that her voice speaks to the central unresolved questions that are facing us today. Certainly, her economic theory, as Cyril has already mentioned, remains of vital importance, even if it was flawed in some respects, since she was the first post-Marxist to grapple seriously with what we now call the globalization of capital. Her political theory, as well as Helen Scott's comments just suggested, remain of vital importance because of her critique of both reformism and revolutionary authoritarianism. Her deep appreciation of mass spontaneity and her understanding that the most important aspect of being a revolutionary is to keep an open mind for the unexpected, of what masses of people can do at their own and historical turning points, keeps coming back every time a new challenge is issued to existing society, as certainly these ongoing events in the Middle East and North Africa shows. What I especially focus on is a vibrant personality which was not afraid to challenge the central orthodoxies that defined and for the most part to continue to define radical discourse. Yes, she was a revolutionary materialist, and anyone reading her economic writings can't escape noticing that, yet she unabashedly referred to herself in her letters and elsewhere as an idealist. Indeed, she held that the most important aspect of social movements and revolutionary struggles is what she called the intellectual sediment that they leave behind for future freedom struggles. She didn't know, of course, that Marx himself had defined his philosophy as a new humanism that represents, as Marx put it, the unity of idealism and materialism, since the works in which Marx said that were not available in her lifetime. But she was not afraid to break out of the confines of existing radical discourse by defining herself in her own terms. Her audacity as a thinker and a person was most of all reflected, I believe, in the way she raised the central unanswered question of our time, of her time and of ours, namely, what happens after the revolution? She certainly supported revolutionary struggles and movements wherever they occurred, in 1917 and Russia included. But she understood that the best support that could be given fellow revolutionaries was criticism, especially when mistaken ideas and policies lead them astray. She was a true visionary in raising the critical question that all too many leftists overlooked in the 20th century, and many still do today, the inseparability of democracy and socialism. As close as she was in many respects to the political figures of her time, such as Kautsky and Lenin, what separated her from them, I think, was her profound understanding, as she wrote in 1918, that socialism by its very nature cannot be decreed or introduced by ukase, by even the best-intentioned leader or party. As she put it, quote, the negative, the tearing down, can be decreed, but the building up, the positive, cannot. New territory, end quote. She understood that a new society cannot be dedicated by relying on a single-party state, a secret police, or a revolutionary leadership that treats differences in democratic debate as a mere impediment to power. She was not afraid to sharply criticize Lenin and Trotsky on these grounds. Even though the revolution had only recently occurred and was being attacked by hostile forces of imperialism and the right. Socialist democracy, she insisted, and I'm quoting her again, is not something that begins only in the promised land after the foundations of socialist economy are created. It begins simultaneously with the beginnings of the destruction of class rule and the construction of socialism. It begins at the very moment of the seizure of power, end quote. Now, I think this is really where Luxembourg's contribution most comes to life for us today. That is, there's a very important ethical component to Luxembourg's critique of her fellow revolutionaries that has not been viewed as essential by many over the past 100 years. She understood that there are limits to what can or should be done in the pursuit of power and in the advancement of the great cause. Any acts that violate the human dignity of those the revolution is meant to liberate must be criticized and put aside. Yes, there are limits to what is to be done, limits that are established by the subjectivity of the subject itself. In this sense, I think we need her voice most of all, because the failure to directly and adequately address the question, what happens after the revolution, remains one of the most formidable missing links in leftist theory and practice. Clearly, the key problem of our own era is the ease with which the oppressed become the new oppressor, the radical and revolutionist, the new bureaucrat and authoritarian. We certainly cannot expect to successfully renew the radical project without addressing the question of how to avoid this from happening again. Now, I imagine that one might say, well, okay, she spoke to these kinds of issues in some of her work, like her critique of reformists for failing to respond adequately to the 1905 Russian Revolution, or her critique of the Bolsheviks in the book of 1918, The Russian Revolution itself. But surely not all of her work addresses this kind of question of what happens after. Now, certainly I would never claim that she answered the question for us either, and these criticisms or comments are certainly valid. However, I would contend that the character of Luxembourg's work, and as well as personality, especially in terms of its expansiveness, speaks to this issue of what happens after, even if indirectly, all of it. You see it, for instance, in her struggles within the radical movement against those whose vision of liberation she held to be stilted or incomplete. As her letters make clear, she had to claw her way to the top of the international socialist movement. Many barriers were placed in her path, not the least of them being sexism. To give just one example, August Bebel, the renowned author of the book Woman Under Socialism, referred to her in his letters to Kautsky as that poisonous bitch. It's quite occurred quite often, this kind of material. This material became public after her death. It's simply not true that she simply ignored such attacks. She certainly was aware of them at the time. She responded, but in her own way, by showing through extended discussion and debate that the real problem was that hidden under the cover of their radical posture was that her colleagues had a stilted concept of liberation that failed to measure up to a vision of the kind of society that, to use Marx's phrase, is one in which all relations in which the human essence materializes itself in an inhumane manner in opposition to itself is overcome. You can't reduce a thinker to their personality, certainly, but neither can you separate the two when it comes to someone like Luxembourg. For her independent personality as well as commitment to the idea of freedom gave her the audacity to openly issue such sharp critiques of her fellow revolutionaries, whether in 1905 or in Russia 1918, long before the full tragedy of the latter revolution was played out in Stalinism. The problem that we're facing today, of course, is that this emancipatory spirit remains something to be repositioned within the discourse of the left. And in a certain sense, it's been missing in the left for too long. How else do we explain leftists who support a Holocaust denier like Iran's Ahmadinejad just because he opposes U.S. imperialism, or who today, quite a number I can mention, defend Libya's Gaddafi because he opposes NATO airstrikes even while slaughtering his own citizens? And how else to explain the relative lack of discussion of what remains the most important question of all? What exactly is a genuine socialist society that transcends the limitations of what passed for the alternative to capitalism in the 20th century? So, friends, to be frank, this is the reason we're issuing the complete works of Rosa Luxemburg in English, a collection that will not only be the only complete edition of her writings in English, but the most complete edition of her writings in any language. That is, it's about time we had access to her entire contribution. Of course, we need to read that contribution critically. She didn't get everything right. In fact, there's a number of things she got wrong. But that's precisely what Luxemburg would want, I think, for us to engage her critically in light of the problems we're facing today. After all, the principle that Marx heralded in 1843, namely ruthless criticism of all that exists, and that was a phrase, by the way, that she was fully familiar with because she reviewed the volume of Marx's early writings in which that piece appeared, is definitely something that she lived for. So what we want to try to do with this work around issuing the letters of Rosa Luxemburg, but as well the complete works of Rosa Luxemburg as a whole, is to engage in this critical discussion without losing sight of the creative power of the negative. That is, the vision of totally new human relations, of a new humanism that defines so much of her own life and work. For this reason, we not only need her complete works, but we also need all of you here in this room to help us, to assist us in this effort of bringing these complete works to life, given the huge amount of time, effort, and expense that will be devoted to trying to make this project over the next decade of the complete works of Rosa Luxemburg a reality.